One thing nice about this as I'm looking at it is that you can see the eyes. It's really, really interesting. Eyes have so much to do with acting. I've always been somebody that liked to see the eyes because I feel it's the focal point of acting. It's deciding how best to create the mood or feeling of what you're doing. Operating is a joyful part of picture making for a cameraman because you get to like get the image exactly the way you want it rather than interpreted by an operator after you've led him or her to what you're striving for. It's fun photographing a piece that's in such beauty, natural beauty as this, and to like get to know it and choose the locations and wander around and picnic in it and look at the light, the way it falls and all of that. I should be paying them rather than the other way around to do this job. I remember this. This is Upper Bryce or Upper Zion. I love this place. I go back every now and then. When I was doing commercials with Haskell Wexler, I'd go back and sit around and look at the old spots that we shot in like this and see what was left and think about the passions involved getting this on film the way we have. Very proud of this picture. Very contemporary story. Those are the kind of films I love to get a hold of and don't often get a chance to do. Stuff that like goes on forever about some basic and important human condition that is bigger than all of us and will go on forever no matter in what era it's set in. I feel really privileged to have been part of this story. There's something about this violence that is palatable for me though. You know, it's not about blood, not about body parts falling apart and things like that. It's plenty violent, huh? But so much fun telling stories with pictures. It's really a complex kind of thing to do. It's as complex as writing music or writing stories, you know, that kind of thing. And it's a language that that's hard to get to know. It's as complex a language as music, you know. It's got 88 keys, and you can use them in any complex way you want to. But we got the sun and the light. Jesus, is there anything more complex than light? I'm one of those guys who doesn't do a lot of augmenting, but like who knows how to take the accident and turn it into something wonderful, magical. I look for that. I thrive on it. I feed on it. I don't invent stuff. It invents itself, and then I notice it and use it dramatically. That's the way I've always been. It's I don't like figure things out ahead of time before the actors do. It would be wrong for me to think of like figuring something out for an actor to do. I'd like to see what they want to do. Then I'd like to like see it in a very good way, and or help dissuade them from it into something else. But actors are the ones who bring the characters alive, and cameramen, you know, are interpreters of their efforts. George let me figure a lot of stuff out, you know what I mean? He, like, trusted me. And we discussed everything about, like, how we should do this. For instance, I remember climbing cliffs and things like that. How are we going to attack this? Well, you know, I made a suggestion that why don't we go from extreme long shots to extreme close-ups and that way advance the climbing up the hill. And it gives you a good sense of place, and then you get into the nitty-gritty of the danger of it and all that kind of thing. And he'd go for that stuff, you know what I mean? It's like it was all a collaborative talking process. This is a great way to look at a movie, by the way. But it doesn't have the same emotional impact as a 30-foot screen, 15 feet high, has 45 feet away from you. It's an entirely different emotional experience. The five factor, it's called, being your distance away from the screen and the emotional reaction that movement and image size and things have to do. My God, a face that's 20 feet high, 30 feet from you. What an unreality that is. And that's what movies are about. It's creating that it's creating the emotional aspects of that unreality that we call technique, artistry, craftsmanship, and using it to move the audience's emotions around. It's a great art form. And boy, am I lucky that I got a D plus in journalism and had to change my major. Saw this in the liberal arts and science manual, cinema, in 1948. What a great time to get in on the ground floor of an art form that started turn of the century, which was 48 years earlier, right? I'm going to stick with this until I drop dead on the set someplace, or like I'm going to try my hand at directing too for a little bit, but I'll never call myself a director. I just want to be the final word in telling the story at some point, and I feel that I have helped directors, and so I like feel qualified to be able to do this thing. And, it'll be fun to talk to actors rather than not talk to actors. Cinematographers are not supposed to talk to actors, and I respect that. It gets confusing when there are too many people talking to you. So, but I enjoy, I'll enjoy being able to talk to actors and hearing what they think and deciding on how to approach characterization and all that kind of thing. It'll be wonderful. Looking forward to it. What do I look for? Oh, my cinematographer. Somebody who won't give me too much trouble when I want to do it my way. It's like Richard Brooks said. He said, when I first walked on the set of The Professionals, before I had a chance to do anything artly, he said, I suppose you want to be a director someday. And I said, well, geez, I hadn't. Yeah, maybe. I mean, you know, I'm not thinking about it right now. I can tell you that. And he said, well, he said, probably everybody should direct at least one film. But, you know, you may find out that you're really suited to it, or you may find out that it's too much work and you're not suited to it, that your talents lend to something else. But whatever, direct your own film. Don't direct mine. That experience, doing that film, every film is one of the most enriching experiences that a person can have, because it's so involved with the creative aspects of telling the story for somebody to go and spend 2 hours looking at and have their emotions moved about. And you have all of these experiences with all these fellow film people, you know, your crew and the actors and people on location, all that kind of thing, or in the studio, wherever. And it's a remarkable, it's like going to war, I guess, huh? Or something like that, without the danger of anything except maybe getting fired now and then. But I consider it one of the most wonderful things to be doing, to tell stories and to be involved with them for 3 months, 4 months, 2 months, 6 months, whatever, and then get on and do an entirely different experience with different people. And it's a very enriching way of having a life, I must say. But actually, perfection is not anything anybody should go for, you know, not the actors, not the director, not the production designer, not the cinematographer. Life is not about perfection. It's about the beauty and excitement in the imperfection of life. Huh? And I've never been somebody that could get a movie to look exactly perfect like I see a lot of people do, you know what I mean? Victoria Storaro's movies are all just absolutely impeccable, and a whole bunch of others too. And mine are always sort of flawed somehow or other. And in a way, I don't mind that, because it's not about perfection. It's about the overall feeling of the thing. And in fact, to make something look better sometimes, it's nice to have it look ordinary for a while, to create a kind of venue for the extraordinary stuff. Because if everything looks beautiful all the time, it gets sort of, you know, too much sugar. This is before the days of video screens and everybody hanging around and watching things on the video screen. The director and the cinematographer would talk it over and decide what to do and then go out and do it. And we trusted each other. And he trusted me to, like, deliver an image that would tell his story, you know, really well. And I trusted him to decide what we needed, what we didn't need, and to do, and all of that was part of a mutual invention that doesn't exist much anymore, unfortunately. You know, more often than not, you're told what to do by somebody standing by a monitor talking to somebody that, like, you're not sure what his job is on the picture, and I'm glad I had it this way. Endings are always hard to do in film. Every picture I've ever been on, you feel so uncertain how to end the story. You know what I mean? It's like such a responsibility to decide definitively what it should be. And it's always an area of last-minute searching to find the good way, the way that's lasting.